And I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray, find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him my own. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed in white as snow. Change the leather spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him my own. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed in white as stone. And when Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all to him my own. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed in white as snow. He washed in white as snow. He washed in white as snow.
Good morning, church. We are continuing in our series today, The Abundant Life. And if you remember, our theme verse for this series is John 10:10, where Jesus said, I have come to give them life and to give it to them more abundantly. And we're looking at this abundant life and trying to see, do we really have it? Do we have the abundant life? And there's certain characteristics or traits that we'll have in our lives that will show us that it's evidence of the abundant life. And today's topic is endurance. And our text comes from Hebrews chapter 10. So if you have your scriptures ready or your Bible apps, turn to Hebrews chapter 10. Well, back when my daughter Tracy was in high school, I used to go to the Brunswick Rec Center gym to work out with a trainer. And it was kind of cool because the trainer was also a Christian, and we often talked about the similarities of physical training and spiritual training. And once we were talking about the subject of weightlifting and the two approaches that athletes adopt when they're training. And here's what I learned. Heavy weights lifted fewer times in succession produces greater strength, but lighter weights lifted with more repetitions produce greater endurance. But when it comes to life, most of us can lift a heavy weight now and then. And thankfully, in our lives, we often only have to do it once or twice. In other words, those major problems that come and then they pass and we get through it, we can deal with those. But for me, it's not the big problems that are the hardest. For me, the problems that are the toughest to overcome are the problems that just never seem to get solved, the ones that just keep coming back. And I believe that God wants you and I to be strong men and women of faith. And to achieve that, we have to become people of resilience and endurance. If I cannot stand under the adversity of unrelenting pressure, I'm going to lose my joy, and the joy of my journey will just not be very valuable as a warrior of the faith. And there's this verse in the Bible that just never ceases to challenge me. It's Hebrews 10:36. And I want you, as you're sitting there, would you just read it along with me, just the beginning of it, out loud. It's real short. Are you ready? Here we go. You have need of endurance. Now, just to make sure you got it, turn to your neighbor if there's someone sitting beside you and say, you have need of endurance. For me, endurance is needed because, as someone once told me, the Christian life is so daily. It requires sustained determination, and that's why God wants to infuse you and me with this can-do attitude of supernatural endurance and perseverance. We cannot give up in the midst of stress. Stress we will have, what we do with it is our decision. So here's the whole context of that verse, Hebrews 10:35 and 36. It reads, therefore, do not cast away your confidence, which has great reward, for you have need of endurance, so that after you have done the will of God, you may receive the promise. We have need of endurance. We need to remember that, all of us, that the Christian life is not a 100-yard dash. It's a marathon run. And as we mentioned already, it's just so daily. You get up every morning, and there it is. The Christian life staring you right in the face. What are you going to do with that life today? How are you going to respond when you go through the stuff that always accompanies life with us? So from here, from the 58th book of the Bible, here from the book of Hebrews are some strategies that help us develop this quality of endurance in our lives. And we'll just take them one by one and explore them as we go through these verses. First of all, embrace your adversity. And you say, Pastor, I've heard you say a lot of things, but that's the most counterintuitive thing I've ever heard in my life. Whoever in the world wants to embrace their adversity? But the Bible is very clear that sometimes the way God teaches his children endurance is through adversity. James 1, 2, and 3 says, Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know it's that this testing of faith produces perseverance. So often when stuff happens to me that I wasn't expecting, and I had a few of those things recently, I'm tempted, first of all, to ask why. Well, you know, you can ask God why all you want. Pastor John just spent 6 weeks on the book of Job. You know what? God's just not obligated to answer. But I think our question ought not to be why all the time. Perhaps it ought to be what? Well, God, what do you want me to do with this during my life? What do you want me to learn, God? How can I embrace my adversity to become more enduring follower of Christ? Here's the second thing. Surround yourself with champions. Once again, from the book of Hebrews, this time from the 12th chapter. The 12th chapter of Hebrews begins with the word therefore. And in order to understand the therefore of Hebrews 12, we have to understand the content of Hebrews 11. And Hebrews 11 is a chapter in the Bible where all the Old Testament saints are listed, and they're given honors for their faith and their faithfulness to God and for their endurance, and they're called champions. Hebrews 11 is often called the Hall of Fame or the Hall of Faith of the Bible. And Hebrews 12, verse 1, makes us sure that we understand how important chapter 11 is, because here's what it says. Let me also finish that verse now, because it says, therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. We need to understand that we'll never know the value of Hebrews 11 unless we understand that the witnesses of Hebrews 11 are not seeing witnesses, they're saying witnesses. They're speaking to us out of history about their victories, and we learn about them through studying about their lives and following their faith journey and watching how God used them in a mighty way. And when we're going through something, we need to call up one of those witnesses and let them speak to our lives. That's why it's good for us to study the Old Testament. That's why we're told to love those old stories of the Bible, because those stories are witnesses to us. They say, you can do it. You can make it. Just look at this person. Look how they made it through. Look at how God helped them out. You can do it. How do we know that? Because they did. And they're going to tell you what happened in their life. And as you study their faith journey, you get to be blessed and encouraged like you wouldn't believe. We have to gather around us some champions if we're going to make it. And one of the best and most enjoyable things we can do to develop endurance in our lives is to learn how it was achieved in the lives of others. And the Bible is one of the greatest sources for those stories. But you know, it's not the only source. You can also read stories of others who have struggled through life. And some people say, well, you should just only be reading the Bible, but not really. Even people who don't know God and don't know Jesus can help us with endurance in our lives. And we might say, well, they're not Christians. How can they really help me out? But just watch what they do. In the book of Philippians, when Paul is giving us the story of how we're to deal with stuff, and he gets all done with the prayer section, and then he says, by the way, think on these things. And he lists a list of qualities of things that we can think on. And not one of them are necessary spiritually qualities. Things that are good and truthful. Things that are pure and lovely. Things that are kind of general qualities. And I think that gives us some permission to realize that not everyone in our world is a Christian. And many other people have something to contribute to our lives. Could I just say a word here, though, and I don't really have a lot of time to spend on it, but there may be some people in your life who aren't champions. In fact, they might be the people that are tearing you down. And I want to tell you, we can't afford to have too many of those speaking into our life if we're going to keep going and living our life of faith with endurance. We need champions to speak to our lives. And you may say, well, I'm just trying to be their friend. And you know, we can be their friend, but here's the key. If they're tearing you down more than you are lifting them up, we might as well be thinking about not hanging around with them too much. So we need to embrace our adversity. We need to surround ourselves with champions. And then number three, we need to find our passion and pursue it. If you get a chance, go back and read Philippians chapter 3 and Paul's discussion on how he pressed on towards the goal and he wouldn't look back either way. Forget those things that were behind and pressed on towards the things that were before. So if we're going to build endurance in our life, we have to embrace adversity. We have to surround ourselves with champions. We have to have our passion and pursue it. And we need to get rid of what's holding us back. Here's what Hebrews 12:1 says. Let us lay aside every weight and sin that so easily ensnares us. The writer of Hebrews says that the Christian life is like running a race, and nobody runs a race in overcoats and boots. You may notice that when they run races in the Olympics, they just have on just enough clothing to be less than indecent as they run the race. And we may know from the painful experience that unbelief erodes our confidence in God. And I believe that that was the sin that Paul was talking about that was holding back the Hebrews. They had once believed that God was sufficient, but now they had lost their confidence. And they were afraid to go forward because they had forgotten that God, who had helped them before, would help them now. It's a particular form of unbelief that's very damaging. We start feeling sorry for ourselves, and then this weight becomes around us. I'm not going to spend too much time there this morning, but identifying the weight that's holding you back, that's the reason that I don't have to do that is because I think most of us already know what that weight is. We know. It's the thing that gets in our way over and over and over again. And we're trying to have some momentum for God, and we're trying to move forward and serve Him, but every time we turn around, this weight gets in the way. What I'm challenging today in the words of Hebrews is to get rid of that weight. To get rid of it. Don't just put it over here on the side. Destroy it. Completely get it out of your experience. Don't let that weight hold you back from serving God and knowing the joy that He wants you to have in this abundant life. Number 5, don't even think about quitting. The second half of Hebrews 12:1 says, "Let us run with endurance the race that was set before us." Did you know that in the book of Hebrews, this little phrase, "let us," occurs more than 13 times, and it speaks to us every time. Yes, God helps us, and we can never do it without His grace, but we have a part too. Let us. Let us go forward. Let us get in this race. Let us don't sit back and passively watch life go by when there's something that God has called you to do. There's this secular book that spoke to my life this year. It's a book that has a really interesting little name. It's called Grit. And the title of this book, written by Angela Duckworth. And this little book, she does a study on what makes people succeed. And she's trying to play off with two different ideas of success. One idea of success is that you succeed because you were born with the right genes, and you have great parenting, and you grew up in a good home, and you had all the advantages, so you succeed. The other model says, no, success has little to do with that, but not very much. Success is more about your passion and your perseverance in going after a goal. And she determined that grit, that was the term she gave it, was the key to success. And here's how she defines grit. She says to be gritty is to keep putting one foot in front of the other. To be gritty is to hold fast to an interesting and purposeful goal. To be gritty is to invest day after day and week after week in a challenging practice. To be gritty is to fall down 7 times and to get back up 8. And she shares so many stories in this book about people who have been and done just that. And one of my favorite was a story about the actor Will Smith, who explains his successes in the entertainment industry in this way. Will said, "The only thing that I see distinctively different about me is I'm not afraid to die on the treadmill. I will not be outworked," he said. Period. You might have more talent than me, you might be smarter than me, you might be all of those things, you've got it on me in 9 categories, but if we get on the treadmill together, there's 2 things. You're either going to get off first, or I'm going to die. It's really just that simple. What was he saying? He was saying he wasn't going to quit. He was saying that he was going to stay after it. The Bible says that we must run with the perseverance of the race that is set before us. We must not give up. There's this true story of this guy named Eric Wyndham Mayer. What a name. Eric was the first blind man to successfully climb the top of Mount Everest, the highest point on the earth. The story of that Herculean accomplishment was told in the book, Touch the Top of the World. And shortly after that, what happened next after Mount Everest, as Eric was completing his Everest descent, his team leader spoke to him these words, which profoundly affected the next chapter in his life. He said, Eric, don't let Everest be the greatest thing you ever do. Meaning, don't create a mausoleum on your trophies and retire on your laurels. And you know what? Many years later, after 6 full years of intense training, Eric solo kayaked the mighty rapids of the Grand Canyon, 277 miles blind, a feat way more difficult than climbing Mount Everest. What did he do? He just wouldn't stop. He wouldn't quit. He wouldn't look back and say, this is what I've done. For this man, his dreams were far more important than his memories, and he kept fighting. I would be so honored to meet such a man, with such endurance. And then the Bible also reminds us that we have to stay focused on our goal. Read what happened to Jesus as he went through so that he could accomplish his goal. He endured the cross. He anticipated the joy that would follow, and we endure because he endured. He endures still, both now and forever. In fact, it's no overstatement to say that our ability to endure whatever life throws at us is rooted and grounded in the enduring quality of God. Colossians 1 verse 11 is a key text, and it reminds us of this divine cooperation that we've been talking about today. Paul wrote to the Colossians and he said, being strengthened with all power and according to his glorious might. Why do we need to be strengthened with all power according to his glorious might? So that we may have great endurance and patience. The Bible says that we are building our lives. We should seek endurance and follow God's command and get in the stream of what God wants to do in our lives. And we can be sure that if we get in the stream of what God wants to do in our life, we can be sure that his glorious power and his might will be at the very core of our lives. And that's what we're going to need to be enduring and resilient in life. I don't know about you, but I want to be an enduring follower of Christ. I don't want to be a dropout. I don't want to be a casualty. I'm not going to quit, and I don't want you to quit. I don't want you to quit on God. I don't want you to quit on Jesus. I don't want you to quit on the scriptures. I don't want you to quit on your wife or your husband or your children or your grandchildren. I don't want you to quit on your neighbors. I just don't want you to quit on life. Quitters almost every single time look back with regret. So let's not quit. Let's go on. Let's continue building our life as we become people of God. Let us do work together. Let us strengthen one another. And when things are going through, they're tough, let's remember that it's not always a negative thing. God may just be getting you ready for something special, and you're going to be a champion. So in this abundant life, do you have it? God's calling us to be enduring, to have endurance and perseverance, and move on for him, and allow him to get the glory. Thank you. God bless.
Lots of room, and I never would have seen it if I wasn't rolling with you.